Hi, I'm Jim Schlexer from Professional Drinking. I'm a certified sommelier, and I want to spend some time talking about the 100-point wine scale. It's something we see all the time when we go to the wine store. So how do we interpret it, and what does it mean? Well, the first thing is, you can't compare one wine to the other. A German Riesling doesn't compare to an Australian Shiraz, doesn't compare to a Napa Cabernet Sauvignon. When we look at the 100-point wine scale, it's got to be within the category. So is a 100-point Napa Cabernet Sauvignon better than an 80-point Napa Cabernet Sauvignon? Most likely. But I can't compare it to another kind of wine. So that's the first thing about the 100-point wine scale, is you can't compare different kinds of wine too well. So how do they build the 100-point wine scale? Well, the first thing is, you got to realize you get 50 points just for signing your name. In other words, if you see a 50-point wine, which you'll never see, it just means it's wine. That's all it means. You get that just for showing up. The next 5 points are for color and appearance. And these are all evaluated by experts. So they look at the color and the appearance. Is it appropriate for that kind of wine? Is it intense? And so forth. The next 15 points are for aroma and bouquet. So you've seen wine people putting their nose in the glass and smelling intently. What they're looking for is a complicated and interesting aroma and bouquet appropriate for that particular grape and that particular area. The more typical it is, the more appropriate it is, the more interesting it is, the more of those 15 points that they're going to get. Well, then they're going to taste. The next 20 points are flavor and finish. So does it have intense flavor? Is it complicated and layered? Is it interesting? Does it have a nice, long, and interesting finish? If it has all of those things, it's going to get more of those 20 points. A simple wine, by comparison, one that sort of you drink it and that's all there is not going to get as many of those 20 points. And the last 10 points of the 100 points is overall impression. So this is sort of a subjective characteristic of, does this wine please me? Is it a great wine? Does it feel like a great wine? And again, these are all evaluated by people that have tasted thousands of wines, so they really do know their wine. So what wine should I go for? Well, the first thing you got to know is you're never going to see a wine below 80 points in a store. First of all, if you know it's not great wine, odds are you're not going to get it tested in the first place. It's not going to help your marketing to say, hey, we got a 72-point wine, but we're trying harder. You're going to wait till you have a better rating. So 70 to 80 points are generally considered flawed wines. They're not really good wines. You don't want to drink them. Between 80 and 84, it's above average. It's not a bad wine, actually. You probably want to try it. You'll do well. They should not be incredibly highly priced at that cost, at that price, at that point level, but they're going to be decent wines to carry around. 85 to 90, very good wine. Quite a nice example of what we're looking at. It's well worth drinking, particularly if the price point is right. Well, now we get into the interesting stuff. 90 to 94 points. These are excellent wines, great examples of what they are, probably from a really good year as well. You can go to any place with a 90 to a 95 point wine and you'll be real happy. And then above 95 points, this is into the rare air. These are a very small percentage of all wines, but these are benchmarks, epic wines, classic examples of the wine that we're tasting. So if you get a 95 or 96 or 98 point wine, it's a great example of that wine. Of course, the price is probably going to follow as well. So if you're thinking about points, I said don't compare one wine to another, but within a category, more points is generally better than less points. And if you're looking for great wine, go for 95 plus.